church in northern Greece. It's a church that started outside of the city walls, a congregation that held a very special place in his heart because it was the church, first church that Paul planted in Europe after having received the Macedonian vision to come to Europe and to help plant the kingdom of God in Europe. He's now riding to this church in Philippi. My wife and I have had the privilege of walking those ancient streets. And he's riding to them, thanking them for their generous giving, because Paul wanted them to realize that there is something that takes place in the kingdom of God when there is the giving and sending church and the going missionary. And so Paul wrote them to say thank you. I want us to read chapter 4, verses 15, 16, and 17. Moreover, as you Philippians know, in the early days of your acquaintance with the gospel, when I set out for Macedonia, not one church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving, except you only. So they were the only ones that gave to him. For even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent me aid again and again when I was in need. Not that I am looking for a gift, but I am looking for what may be credited to your account. So he wrote this church not because he was wanting another offering, but he wanted to give them an update to let them know, church, this is what happened when you gave to a missionary. This is what happens through that partnership. Now, as I was preparing to speak for your missions convention this weekend, I really sensed in my heart that the Lord wanted me to share our story as missionaries with you. Because we're not anything supernatural. There's nothing super fancy special about us. We are just simply people who have made ourselves available to kingdom service. And aren't you glad God is in the business of using ordinary people to do extraordinary things? Amen. You know, the Bible says that we overcome the enemy by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. I believe that what I share with you this morning, the Lord is going to use to implant something deep within your heart that you're going to walk out of here saying, Lord, here am I. Use me to touch hurting people with the good news of Jesus Christ. Now, our story begins over 30 years ago in Bible school, because it was in Bible school that the Holy Spirit began to speak to my heart about serving as a missionary. It was in Bible school that he placed a call upon my heart to serve him as a missionary to France and to the French-speaking peoples of Europe. My wife came to Bible school with the call of God to serve as a missionary. She was determined to be a single one in Africa all of her life. I'm glad God changed those directions and plans. It was in Bible school that I had my first opportunity to go to the mission field. I was approved to spend the summer working with the Great Assemblies of God Church in the city of Paris, France. The minute that I got off the airplane and cleared customs and immigration, I began running with this congregation. It is to this day a thriving, growing church. It has 4 services a week. It has many outreaches into the community. And when I arrived, just the pastor and his wife were bearing the brunt of the load. So I began running the minute I got off the airplane. I began to lead worship in that church in French and couldn't even speak the language. I learned how to pronounce the words and would just get up and lead the congregation. I would preach on Sunday evenings. I would direct the choir on Sunday afternoons. On Saturday, they put me in charge of overseeing all of their evangelism teams that went onto the streets of Paris. Because of the giving of Light for the Lost, that church was able to get income, money from the Assemblies of God in America and print gospel tracts. And every Saturday, we were on the streets of Paris preaching Jesus. Our choir was singing. We had street preachers. We had mime. We would stand side by side of witches at the exit of subway stations, handing out tract after tract after tract that was provided by Light for the Lost. 100,000 gospel tracts we distributed each and every month on the streets of that major city. Many times when the French would get this tract and they would discover it was about Jesus, because of the hardness of their hearts, they would take it, they'd wad it up, they'd throw it on the ground. Sometimes they would curse at you, spit at you as they continued their journey. But we learned to not even let that hinder us, because the Lord can even use crumpled up pieces of paper lying in a gutter if he so chooses.
Amen.
One Friday night, get church on Friday in France. We were worshiping when a very dejected lady walked into the building carrying a crumpled up piece of paper. We would later find out her name was Madame Sapoti, and we would learn her story. All of her life, she had been raised as an atheist. God did not exist. He was a figment of your imagination. Only weak people believed in a God. But into her 60s, she wasn't feeling very well and went to her doctor for medical tests and discovered that she had terminal cancer and was only given just a few months to live. The day that she received that bad report from the doctor, she walked out of his office crying, and she had her head bowed low so nobody on the streets would see her tears. And as she walked down the street towards her apartment, she noticed a piece of crumpled up paper in the gutter, and something spoke to her and said, "Pick it up!" That day she bent down, and amidst all the garbage in the streets of Paris, she picked up this wadded up piece of paper and she smoothed it out, and it was one of those gospel tracts that someone in the church had handed out. She read the gospel on the back, gave the name, the address, how to get there by subway, and that evening she went to church for the first time in her life. She heard the gospel, and when the altar call was given, Madame Sapoti made her way to the front, accepted Jesus as her Savior, shared with us that she was dying of cancer. We anointed her with oil. And friend, I'm here to tell you that for 20 years, you could go to Vie Evangelique, Vie Nouvelle in Paris. You could walk into that church and you would find Madame Sapoti sitting on the front row, worshiping the God that heals, fills with the Holy Spirit, and saves, because God healed her of terminal cancer. He gave her a ministry for 20 years. She ministered to the Jewish people of Paris, winning many of them to the Lord. That's what happens when you invest in missions. When you write out your monthly check and send, give it to this church to send to a missionary, when you pray for a missionary, that's what happens when you partner. Lives are snatched from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light. That's what takes place. Pretty exciting. After serving with that church for 3 months, it was time for me to come back to America to finish Bible school. And I just couldn't bear to leave that couple by themselves. And so I made the decision that I would finish my education in Europe, and so I transferred from a Bible school in the United States to a theological seminary in Brussels, Belgium. And for 2 years, our life was quite hectic. Monday through Friday, we were in Brussels, Belgium, studying. On Friday afternoon, I would rush home, grab my wife and our suitcase. We would hop a train to Paris, arriving just in time for us to leave our suitcase at the back door as I would go to the piano to begin worship. Saturday directed all the evangelism team. Sunday morning led worship. Sunday afternoon directed the choir. Sunday night I would preach. And then when it was time to give the altar call, the pastor would take over while Drew and I raced out the door to grab our suitcase to take the subway, to catch the train, to go back to Brussels to do it all over again. We thought we would stay in Europe forever. We did not have a dream of coming home. But as we finished up with Bible school, the Holy Spirit began to stir our heart that he wanted us to go back to America to pastor. Well, it made sense to us that if we were working with French people, we now had a command of the French language, that he would want us to continue that work amongst the French. And there's only one area in the United States where they still speak the French language, and that's in southern Louisiana. I called the presbyter for that area. I said, "Brother, we're calling from Europe. We're sensing God bringing us home to pastor. We would like to come to your area." He said, "Brother Huffman, I feel God wants you here, but I want you to know we have no churches available. Come by faith." The day we arrived in Louisiana, the church that we eventually pastored became available. We pastored this church for 3.5 years. It was a 6-year-old church plant, the only Assemblies of God church in the entire county or parish, as it's known in the state of Louisiana. In 3.5 years, we saw the church more than double and became debt-free because we set a missions program in place. Let me tell you, you cannot outgive God. That church before we came was not supporting missions and was struggling. As we instituted missions giving in that church, God began to bless that congregation. They began to grow. They ended up paying off a 30-year debt in 3.5 years, and they more than doubled in attendance. 3.5 years into our tenure there, we experience that stir again of the Holy Spirit. It's time for you to go back into missions. I can remember the day so vividly as my wife and I sat at our kitchen table and we filled out all the forms and applications that are necessary to become a missionary with the Assemblies of God. One of the questions that was asked is, where is God calling you to serve? And they give you 1, 2, and 3. we wrote down France, or we would consider another French-speaking country, and we mailed it off. Well, my wife and I, we began to fast and pray because we knew we needed to hear from God. Because in this life, you will have turmoil and trials and spiritual warfare. It is inevitable. But when you know that you have heard the voice of God, when you've got alone with Him in the holy place and He has spoken to your heart and says that you're to be here and not there, when trials come, you can stand with confidence and say, enemy, throw at me what you want. I shall not be moved because God Himself has called me here.
Right.
That's a word for the Lord for somebody in this congregation this morning. You're in a turmoil and you don't know where to turn, to the left, right, straight, or turn around. I'm here to tell you, the Bible is very clear. My sheep know my voice. You can hear the voice of God for yourself. Get alone with Him. Spend time in His presence. Lay out all the problems before Him and listen to Him speak. He's got a purpose. He's got a plan. He's got clear direction from you. And once you hear it, purpose yourself. Purpose yourself. I shall not be moved. Well, as we prayed and fasted, something began to happen in my heart that did not make any sense, because I began to sense in my spirit the Lord say, you will go to Romania for a season of ministry. Now, I'm a pretty pragmatic individual. The facts are, we had worked with the French. I felt a call to the French in Bible school. They don't speak French in Romania. This cannot be God. So I didn't say anything to my wife. Months into our waiting for approval, We're on the interstate in Louisiana, heading to the next biggest town to go shopping. And as I'm speeding down the highway at 65 miles an hour, my wife looks at me and she says, honey, wouldn't it be something if God would change our plans and directions and send us somewhere like Romania? Joanne almost had a car wreck that day on that interstate. But by the time we met the missions board in Springfield, Missouri, we knew that we knew that we knew that God was calling us to Romania for a season. In 1990, we were appointed the very first Assemblies of God missionaries to that former communist country in Eastern Europe. For 15 months, we traveled across America, raising our budget the way all Assemblies of God missionaries must do. Finally, the day arrived that Springfield said, you can go to the land of your calling. We kissed family goodbye at the Houston airport. We flew across the Atlantic Ocean, and some 18 hours later, we landed in Romania. My first memories, now you've got to keep in mind, Romania is not the way, it's not like that today. But in 1991, it was how I'm about to describe it to you. My first memory of Romania is getting off the plane onto the bus that carried us to the international airport. And that day I straddled a hole that had rusted out in that bus, and I watched the tarmac go under our feet as it carried us to their international airport, which at that time was just bare cement floors and a 40-watt light bulb hanging from bare wires. We began our life in the city of Bucharest. We lived on the ninth floor of an apartment complex with 100,000 other people in our building. We learned to live a new life. We learned to live with limited electricity. We learned to live with very little water. For in the city of Bucharest, they would turn the water on and off at whim. In the wintertime, we never had hot water. In the summertime, we never had cold water. So we had to learn how to live without water. At that particular time, it was difficult to find a lot of food products that you would be used to. It just wasn't there. And we began our ministry in Romania by learning to speak the language of their heart. You cannot share the gospel with people until you can speak to them in the language of their heart. So Drew and I began to learn Romanian in church. It's a great place for a missionary to do language study. I remember the service, the very first one we walked in, they were holding a special service welcoming us to the country. And when we walked in the door, they were already singing a song. And these people back here, I know it. The English translation is, in my heart, I love you, Jesus, in my heart. Well, because they said the word heart so many times, It's the first Romanian word I ever learned. And it's enema. Enema, enema. In Romanesque, enema. I knew I was in trouble, Pastor, when I went to church and they were singing about enemas. And they were laughing and shouting and having a good time in Jesus. I want you to turn to the person beside you, look him in the eye, and say, God bless you, enema. Enema, enema, you tell your best good night. Enema, I think something like that. I forgot. And we quickly saw that the number one need in Romania at that time was to train men and women for ministry. The church was allowed to exist under communism. That wasn't the issue. But they were extremely limited in what they could do. We've actually been in villages, in village churches, where they didn't have a copy of God's word, and all they had was a notebook that they had meticulously copied passages by hand. So you can see where the training of men and women for ministry was of utmost importance in that country. We linked arms with a dear brother, whom one of these families back here knows because that brother baptized him. And we helped to start the Romanian Bible Institute in the city of Bucharest, Romania. And in the last 2.5 decades, it has trained hundreds of men and women for the gospel of Jesus Christ. Not too long ago, we got an email from one of our former students. He had written us to thank us for coming into his country and pouring into his life, because since he's graduated from Bible school, he's gone on to plant 3 churches in Romania and getting ready to plant 1 in London, England. That's what happens when you invest in missions. The kingdom grows in ways that you cannot even begin to imagine. We even got the privilege to train Romania's very first foreign missionary. One of the forbidden things of Romania under the time of communism was that it was really, really, really difficult for the people to get out of their country. So the church really could not send missionaries abroad in the time of communism. But when the doors of freedom swung open wide, the Holy Spirit began to deal with the Romanian church and said, what are you going to do with the Great Commission? And God began to call young people to serve him around this world. We got the privilege to train the very first one. His name was George Gavrush. He went through our Bible school with a burden to reach Muslims for Jesus Christ. When he got out of Bible school, there were no missions agencies that could send him to the Muslim world. So he began to share his dream with youth groups in Romania. And a large portion of his budget has been raised by Romanian youth. For years now, George and his wife and 2 daughters have labored in Afghanistan, winning Muslims to Jesus. Now, friend, that excites me, I think, more than anything else, to realize that when we stand before the throne of grace, we are going to witness Afghan people bowing their knee, worshiping Jesus as their Lord and their Savior. They came to know him through a Romanian missionary that we had the opportunity to train because Assemblies of God churches like Buckeye First Assembly cared enough to support missions and be involved in kingdom business. Friend, when we stand before God, our minds are going to be blown at what happened when we wrote those checks and when we prayed those prayers. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. 4 years into being in Romania, a village church in Transylvania, where Dracula comes from, they invited us to come to partner with them in kingdom work. And Drew and I really sensed that it was the Holy Spirit that we had to do it. So we packed up our apartment in Bucharest. We moved to Transylvania. And we began to partner with this village church in Opna Mureș. At that particular time of history, one of the greatest needs in Romania, if you were going to touch the society, was what do you do with all the abandoned children that the communist regime left? At one time in Bucharest, there were 100,000 abandoned kids sleeping in the sewers. I've been in those sewers. My wife has been in those sewers. We have fed those kids. We have loved on those kids and shared Jesus with those kids. This church said, we've got to do something. One of the widows in the church said, I'll give you my house. We can start an orphanage. She moved in with her sister. We incorporated what we believe was the first Christian orphanage in Romania, called the Sanctuary. What began with very humble conditions, God began to bless. We grew to over 40 kids. To this day, ministry to 40 children. We became known as an orphanage that would take those kids that the society had deemed were hopeless, mentally retarded to the point that they would never amount to anything. We would take those kids that the state just wanted to throw away, and we would let the Holy Spirit do a work that only He could do. I remember one of those little children, a little girl. Her name was Roxanna. When she came to us, her head was shaved completely bald, which was normal for the state orphanages. They did that to keep the lice problem down. The only time she was touched was when her diaper was changed or her bottle was given to her. Other than that, she had no interaction with humanity. They said Roxanna was so retarded that she would basically just exist for the rest of her life. But like all the children that came to sanctuary, she was adopted by the church. All the workers in that orphanage were from the church. When the doors of the church was open, the kids were in church. When holidays came, they were in homes of people of the church. And the Holy Spirit began to do a work in these children's lives. I'm happy to report to you that Roxanna today is almost 20 years old. She is not just a vegetable existing, because God gave her a family. Someone from Times Square Church, New York City, David Wilkerson's congregation, came to our village, fell in love with Roxanna, adopted her. Today, she is studying to be an opera singer in the New York City area. That's what happens when you write your check for missions, when you pray for those missionaries. Lives like Roxanna that the world wants to throw away suddenly have a hope and a future in Jesus Christ. That church began to look at other problems that existed in society. We asked the question one day, how can we prevent families from throwing away their kids? Well, they're getting rid of their children because they can't afford to feed them. Now, this is predominantly in the gypsy population. The church said, we can do something. We can feed poor families in our area so they can stay in the home. So we began a feeding program. We didn't have money, but we had a great big God. The church began to pray and fast. The Lord gave our congregation ideas. We leased property on the outside of the community, began to raise a farm. We raised cows, we raised chicken, we raised pigs, we raised corn. Mama Liga, which is cornmeal mush, is one of the staples of Romanian culture. It's like polenta. And the first year that we raised our farm, Romania went through the worst drought in its history, and there's no irrigation systems like you have in Arizona. It either rains or it doesn't rain. Your crop grows because God blesses it or it doesn't. We went through the worst drought in history. Crops all around us died, but when it came harvesting season, we harvested 120 tons of corn because it was God's farm. And we began to sell the corn to have money to fund the ministry. And to this day, that church feeds 600 kids a day, 5 days a week. Those kids come to the house of God, they're fed a hot meal, the gospel is shared with them, they go home and share it with their moms and dad, and as a result, 4 churches have already been planted amongst the gypsy population. That's what happens when you support missions. That's what happens. What's Romania like today? My, my, my. There are over 500,000 Pentecostals in Romania today. There are more than 2,000 Assemblies of God churches in Romania today. They have their own missions board, and they're sending families around the world, predominantly to Muslim nations, to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. God is using Romania in mighty ways to build the kingdom of God.
Hallelujah.
That's what happens when you give and you pray. We thought we'd be in Romania forever. It became home to us. To this day, our closest friends are still Romanians. 12 years into serving God in that country, the Holy Spirit one morning released us. He said, I'm sending you back to the French-speaking world. We didn't want to go. We were happy where we were, but we went by faith. And for 8 years, we served as the assistant area directors for Western Europe. We developed the Assemblies of God protocol for how to minister to refugees because Europe was being inundated by people from third world countries, and how are we as a denomination, as a mission, going to minister to these people? We developed the protocol for that. And my wife and another missionary lady started Breaking Chains Ministries, which was a ministry to trafficked women in the brothels amongst the prostitutes in Antwerp, Belgium. 4 years ago, we found ourselves in a dilemma. We have one son, at that time was 19 years old. It was time for him to come back to America to start his life. But he'd only been to America three times in 19 years. This was a foreign country to him. He spoke French as well as any Frenchman. You will never know that he was not from Europe. Our son approached us and he said, "I know it's time for me to go back, Mom and Dad, but would you be willing to stay with me in America until I know that I can make it there?" The typical cycle for a missionary is that you are overseas 4 years, you come home for one to raise funds, then you go back. Many times, families leave their kids in America after a year and they flounder and they fail. We lose a lot of our kids in missions because Mom and Dad is halfway around the world and John Jr. is here in America as an American that doesn't understand the culture, the people, or anything. And they don't make it. We made the decision, "Son, we'll do whatever it takes. We'll stay with you." We thought, well, are we going to have to resign missions and pastor a church somewhere? We don't know, but whatever it takes, our son is worth it.
Yes.
We got a phone call from Assemblies of God Missions as we were praying. And they said, "Brother Huffman, we don't know if you're interested or not, but we would like to invite you to come to America for at least 3 years. We are looking for someone who will serve as the director of missions awareness." Now that entailed being in an area of America, pastoring all the missionaries that were home on furlough, raising money, promoting missions in the church for missions, serving as a liaison in all of our Bible schools across the United States to promote missions. They said, "We're looking for someone who will serve the Southwest, and we want to know, would you be willing to do it?" The minute they said that, we said, "That's the answer. That's how the Holy Spirit is going to keep us in America for 3 years. We said, "Yes." They said, "You can live anywhere you want to, from Albuquerque, New Mexico, to Honolulu, Hawaii. Take your pick." Well, I picked Honolulu, Hawaii. But, you know, you couldn't afford. You might imagine the airline tickets every week, come back, to, you know, forget it. It wasn't feasible. Los Angeles, too expensive. We looked at a map and said, you know, Phoenix is a central location in the West. It's a major city. It will give our son a future. It has a good airport. I can easily travel out of there. Hey, let's move to Phoenix. So 4 years ago, we packed up our home in Belgium, and we shipped our container of furniture to an unknown address because we didn't have a place to live. And we moved to Phoenix, Arizona, and I began to travel for World Missions. I came home after one weekend of ministry, and I said, "Honey, if all I'm going to do is raise money in churches, I'm going to go nuts. There's got to be something in Phoenix that we can do where people need to hear the good news of the gospel." So we took a drive to the inner city of Phoenix, thinking that we could perhaps volunteer at a halfway house on Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Thursdays when we were in town. Well, lo and behold, our world was just turned upside down. Because when we went into the inner city of Phoenix, it wasn't street people we saw. It was refugees and immigrants. We saw men walking across the street in grass skirts in downtown Phoenix from Burma. And we began to do some research and we discovered that Phoenix is the number one destination in the United States for political refugees. That means that if there is a war going on somewhere in the world, the U.S. will give asylum to people whose lives are in danger. The vast majority of them end up in Phoenix. There's 140 nationalities in this city. 100 of them are what we call unreached people groups, meaning that less than 2% of their people are known to serve Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. It means they're coming from countries that are closed, that you cannot send a missionary to. Well, my Bible says, "For God so loves the world that he gave his only begotten son." So what do you do if you can't go to them to share the good news? He brings them to us.
Amen.
We began to reach out to them, and we became very evident to us that God supernaturally gave us the training to deal with refugees in Europe. He supernaturally planted our feet in Phoenix with us not even knowing this was taking place. And a year ago, we transferred from World Missions to U.S. Missions to serve as the national representative of ethnic ministries. Phoenix has become the prototype of this new wave of missions in the Assemblies of God. In a year's time, we have seen God do incredible things in the Valley of the Sun. The Assemblies of God has an English as a second language ministry downtown. By teaching English to the immigrant, you become their friend. Then you can share Jesus. I can't tell you the number of times Drew and I have gone to the hospital to be with them, to the schools, because they don't understand problems that are taking place. We serve as their liaison because we want to be their friend. Less than 10% of immigrants that come to America will ever have an American friend. Fewer than that will ever meet a Christian who will open their mouth and share their faith. We want to be one of those that will open our mouth. So we go to where they are. Last year, we had 300 students from 23 different nations at the ESL ministry. As we shared Jesus with these immigrants, we prayed, Lord, we've got to plant churches amongst them. But how do we do it? We don't speak the language. God began to send us ethnic pastors. The first fruit of our prayer was a wonderful Arab brother from the country of Jordan. One of our partners in ministry here in Phoenix is a medical doctor. She's Arabic. Because of her Arabic speaking skills, she gets all of the refugees as patients. She's a firm, solid believer in Jesus. When you go to her office, she has two television screens in her waiting room. One screen plays medical issues. The other screen plays the Jesus film in Arabic. Everyone that goes to her office receives a Bible, receives the Jesus film in Arabic. Hands are laid on them, prayed for them. We're seeing miracles take place. She calls us one day and she said, Wayne, Drew, come to my office. There's someone you need to meet. And that day we met Najib Hanna. He said, I'm a pastor. And I was kicked out of Jordan. I said, really? Kicked out of Jordan? Jordan's a pretty free place. How come you were kicked out of Jordan? He said, my church reached too many Muslims and I became a threat to the state. So they told me to leave. I said, what kind of pastor are you? He said, I'm Assemblies of God. Last year, we launched the first Arabic church, Assemblies of God, in downtown Phoenix. In the past year, we've now grown to 3 locations. We now have an Arabic church, surprise. We have an Arabic church in downtown Phoenix. We have an Arabic church in Goodyear. God gave us a television network. Can you believe that? Free of charge. Didn't pay a dime for it. And that pastor is filming the gospel on a weekly basis and through the internet, sending it back to the Middle East. All of this is happening out of Phoenix. We now have a Bible school in Phoenix for Arabs. We have 22 Arab young men learning the word of God so they can become church planters amongst their people, not overseas, but in the inner city of America. In the last year, God has began sending us pastors. We have seen 10 ethnic churches planted in the last year alone. We've got teams of young people, predominantly Romanian. There's 83,000 Romanians in this country, some in this city, and some of them are our former students in Romania. They have a heart, a passion to evangelize this nation, believing God has sent them here to make a difference. So we've trained a team of 20 young people, and every other Saturday, we're going into those inner city apartment complexes downtown, reaching ethnic kids, reaching Muslim children with the gospel of Jesus. We've got Muslim kids who can recite every memory verse for the past 6 months that we've been doing these outreaches. Seed is being planted in the hearts of Muslim children. We started this because we thought, you know what? Kids speak English quick. They pick it up like this. We have no language barrier. Let's reach the kids. They'll then go home and share with their parents. Right now, our team is in 3 apartment complexes, and we have invitation into 18 others. We just need more teams that'll get involved with us. We are seeing an incredible move of the Holy Spirit in the Valley of the Sun. We're seeing God do some extraordinary things here because we've made ourselves available to kingdom service. Remember at the beginning of our testimony this morning, I said God's in the business of using ordinary people to do extraordinary things. We're seeing God do some extraordinary things because we've said, yes, Lord, use me. God wants to use you. He's got a purpose. He's got a plan. He's got direction for every single person in this room. And I've got news for you. His purpose and his plan is not just to attend Buckeye First Assembly and sit in a blue padded chair. God's not called you to that. God has called you to be an active participant in kingdom business. Amen. We've been saved. You know, if he didn't want to use us in kingdom business, the moment we said, Jesus, forgive me and come in the Lord of my life, we could have killed over and died right there. But we have been saved for purpose. God wants to use you. Well, how does God use me? Predominantly, he uses me in three ways. Number one, he uses me in my ability to pray. Ask of me, he says, I'll give you nations for an inheritance. Ask what you will, it'll be given to you. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, that he'll send forth laborers into his harvest. If my people will humble themselves and pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, he heals our land. The Bible is very, very clear that he has called us to a ministry of intercession. Prayer is the greatest weapon that we have in our arsenal to fight the work of the enemy. Nothing happens without prayer. God can do anything he wants to, anytime he wants to do it. He's omnipotent. But he has chosen in his plan for mankind that he will limit his power and authority. He will only move when the church is asking him to do it. Therefore, if the church is not asking, God's not moving. So if we complain about not having revival, it's not God's fault. It's our fault. God will use you, friend, as you get alone with him and pray. He'll also use you in your ability to go. You have 2 feet, don't you? You have been fearfully and wonderfully made by the hand of a creative God. Knitted in your DNA are unique talents, gifts, and abilities that God will use if you'll just make yourself available. When we pastored in Louisiana, we had a dear saint of God. Her name was Miss Effie. She was the wife of the sheriff. And before her conversion, she had lived quite a life of drugs and alcohol and everything else. But one day she met Jesus. And the passion of that lady's life was to tell everybody in that town what Jesus did for her. As she got older, her health failed. She had hip replacement surgeries. They didn't work. She was confined to a wheelchair. She couldn't leave her home the way she wanted to do. And she just really fell into a pit of discouragement, thinking that her life was over. But one morning in prayer, the Holy Spirit spoke to her heart and said, Effie, you can still cook, can't you? And that morning, the Holy Spirit birthed in that lady's heart a ministry of cake baking. That lady made the best carrot cakes I have ever put in. Her carrot cakes are going to be at the marriage supper of the Lamb. They were that good. But she would go to prayer in the morning. The Holy Spirit would lay somebody in the town on her heart. She knew everybody. She would go into her kitchen, grate her carrots, put a cake in the oven, and call them and say, now, honey, when you get off work today, you come at my house. I've got something for you. They would drive up to her home. She'd give them this carrot cake. And she'd share the good news of Jesus. She never left her home, yet she won more people to the Lord than any other person in our congregation. Because she said, Lord, use me. Use me. You have gifts and talents that can be used to touch people that the person beside you will never reach. Make yourself available to go. The last way God uses us is in our ability to give. You know it takes money to operate this church, to replace the air conditioners that by faith are still running, to pay the electric bills, all the expenses. It takes money to do missions. Now, the Assemblies of God is one of the largest mission-sending organizations in the world today. We love missions in the Assemblies of God. But per capita, the average Assemblies of God person, if you take the amount that was given to missions divided by the number of people that attend our churches all across America, per capita, we give 18 cents a day so that the lost will have an opportunity to know Jesus. How many times do you go to Starbucks? How many Coca-Colas do you buy?
our $2 bottles of water, yet we give 18 cents a day. Friend, I think the Lord wants to use us more than just giving Him pennies. Don't you? In a few moments, your pastor's going to come up. It's your Faith Promise Sunday. Every one of you should have one of these. If you don't, in a few moments, the ushers are going to make sure that you have one. And I would ask that everybody in this room have it. All this is just something that this church can use as a tally through which they know how much income by faith is going to be there to support the missions endeavors of this church for next year. Your pastor is never going to call you. He is never going to send you a bill. He is not going to look and say, hey, I saw that you sent in last month, but where's your money this month? He will never do that. No, this is between you and God and this church to have an idea. And I want you to notice something about it. It says, my missions, faith, promise. When you fill this out this morning, let me encourage you not to put down something that you know that you can give. Because if you put down something that you know that you can give, that's not faith. Faith is trusting God. So in a minute, we're going to pray together. We're going to ask God to drop in our heart amounts that's going to blow some of your minds. And when He does, you write it down. And then by faith, you watch God provide. Because God's in the business, friend. All He wants to do is find ordinary people that He can use to do some extraordinary things. I hope our testimonies encouraged you this morning. I hope it's inspired you. If God can use them, certainly He can use me. He'll use you as you pray, as you go, and as you get. I want you to bow your heads across this building. Father, we are so thankful for the privilege of being at Buckeye First this morning. Such a sweetness in this congregation. I pray your blessings upon each and every person here, especially upon this precious pastor and his wife and family. Pray your blessings upon them as they lead this congregation into deeper depths and to higher heights with you. Now, Lord, in a few moments, we're going to take faith promises. Speak to our hearts. Lord, would you put upon our spirit an amount that you want us to write down? And Lord, all we're going to do is say, Lord, we'll do it, and by faith, we're going to see you provide. I pray this will be the greatest missions convention this church has ever had, as 100% participation says, yes, I'll trust Jesus to provide through me. We ask it in Jesus' name.